Now let's look at Mendel's other great contribution to modern genetics. And this is called independent assortment. Remember that meiosis produces genetic variation. And now we're going to look at this in more detail because we're going to be looking at what's called independent assortment of chromosomes. To do this, we're going to take specific examples, breeding experiments as it were, and this will be called a dihybrid cross. And this is a genetic cross in which we'll be tracking the inheritance of two separate traits. So let's stick with Mendel's peas. So we're going to have our parental generation, we're going to have pure breeding pea plants that produce round and yellow seeds. So that's one lineage. We're going to cross them with another lineage that produces wrinkled green seeds. Okay? So when we cross these, we get an F1 generation, and round is dominant to wrinkled, yellow is dominant to green, and so these are now all heterozygotes, and all of them will be round and yellow. That's the F1 generation. Okay? But these are two separate traits. So when we cross two individuals of this F1 generation, they're both round and yellow, what we find is the F2 generation has a very odd pattern. There's now four different phenotypes of the offspring when we're tracking the two traits simultaneously, and they're found in a characteristic ratio. So what are the four combinations? So we have round and yellow, that's the same that we saw in the F1 generation, and we also saw that back in the parental generation. But now we're also seeing round and green. Wait, round wasn't found with green in the parental generation or the F1 generation either. We're getting another new one, wrinkled yellow. That wasn't found. Wrinkle was found with green. It wasn't found with yellow. And then finally, we see wrinkled green. And that, like round yellow, was also found back in the P generation. By performing this cross several times, dozens of times, he could look at the ratio of different phenotypes in the F2 generation. In this particular case, there's 315 round yellow for every 108 round green, every 101 wrinkled yellow, and every 32 wrinkled green. And this comes into a ratio that we do need to keep in mind as we go forward. The ratio here is 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. These are both dominant phenotypes. So there's 9 of the double dominants. Here's just one of the dominant phenotypes, together now with one of the recessive phenotypes. And here's the other combination of dominant recessive. And then here's a double recessive. So for every 9 double dominant, there's 3 of one particular dominant and recessive, 3 recessive and dominant, and only 1 double recessive. We can explain this pattern of 9 to 3 to 3 to 1 using Mendel's law of independent assortment, which explains a pattern of inheritance in these dihybrid crosses. So we start out with a diploid genotype, and then during meiosis, we get haploid gametes, right? Now, let's look at this. So we had in our F1 generation of this dihybrid cross, they were heterozygote for whether they were round or wrinkled. They're also heterozygote for whether they were yellow or green, okay? Now, these are two different traits, and they're going to be passed on in the gametes independently. So after meiosis, a proportion of the gametes will have the capital R allele from this locus or this gene and the capital Y allele from this locus. But it's just as likely as you'll get capital R with little y as it is with capital Y. And you're just as likely to get little r with capital Y as you are the other one, and so on. All four of these combinations are equally likely. That's the law of independent assortment. Now, what we mean by this is if we follow these chromosomes, we have the diploid parental cell, okay? They form their sister chromatids, and then the tetrad. for each of these two different chromosomes. We'll have a long chromosome and a short chromosome, okay? And then the tetrad splits up. But the combination of the chromosomes that originated from one parent or another are equally likely that you would have the long paternal chromosome with the short paternal chromosome as you are to have the long paternal chromosome with the short maternal chromosome, okay? So this individual got its blue chromosomes from its dad and its red chromosomes from its mom, but there's nothing that links these separate chromosomes together from the mom or from the dad. So any combination can be passed on in the next generation in the form of these gametes. So here we have cases where the long blue chromosome is with the short blue chromosome. Those two both did come from the dad, but it's just as likely you'd have the short red with the long blue, and therefore the long red with the short blue. So all four of these combinations are just as likely. So chromosomes from the same parent are not passed in tandem to the gametes of that particular individual. So in meiosis, we'll just do this again. Now we're going to have different color codes. We would have, say, the dominant alleles coming from one parent and the recessive alleles coming from the other parent. Okay? We still have a long chromosome and a short chromosome, but this time they're in different colors. And so in the gametes, it's just as likely that the capital A and capital B alleles will end up in the same gamete as any other combination. Capital A with little b, little a with capital B, and little a with little b. So all four of these combinations are just as likely. There's nothing that means that the whole complement from an individual's mother gets passed on together. No, you can have dad's long chromosome, mom's short chromosome, and if you're doing this with humans, chromosome number one in a particular sperm could come from the dad, chromosome number two from the mom, any combination as could happen. So let's go back and look at what we're doing with a dihybrid cross. Phenotypes as before, round yellow, wrinkled green. Okay. We now are going to do this in terms of genotype. It's a pure breeding line, so it's homozygous for capital R to be round generation after generation. It's homozygous for capital Y to be yellow generation after generation. And these are recessives, so to have the recessive trait, it has to be little r homozygote. And to be green, it has to be little y homozygote, okay? We cross them, and our F1 generation is now a double heterozygote. That is, it's heterozygote at the R locus for round versus wrinkled. And it's also heterozygous at the Y locus for yellow versus green, okay? So when we cross two of these are two double heterozygotes. And so each parent here, each individual here in producing its gametes, all four of these combinations are equally likely because there's nothing making the capital Y go in tandem with the capital R. So all four of these are just as likely from each parent, okay? And so when we cross these, there's 16 possible combinations. Okay, and these are all written out here, and nobody ever has to remember any of this. There are a lot of different genotypes in these 16 different combinations. Again, you don't have to remember this, but just for your knowledge, should you care, there's only one double homozygote, and that's at this one, at this end, and only one double homozygote recessive. And there's all these other combinations with varying numbers of dominant versus recessive at each trait, okay? But if we do this by phenotype, so as long as you have at least one capital R allele and at least one capital Y allele, you show one phenotype or the other, it simplifies down to this 9:3:3:1. So 9 of these have at least one capital R and one capital Y. There's 3 that have at least one capital R, but no capital Y, at least 3 that have no capital R, but at least one capital Y, and then just the one that has no dominant alleles whatsoever. So this is 9:3:3:1. That's how we get that ratio And it's because of independent assortment. Now, in humans, we can look at independent assortment. And if we think about the number of chromosomes that we have 23 pairs, okay? And the number of possible combination in the gametes is there's, for each pair, okay, there's two different ways it can be. And so to think of all these possible combinations, it's 2 to the 23rd, okay? 2 to the 23rd possible combinations of our parental chromosomes recombining in our gametes, okay? And so each individual human is capable of producing 2 to the 23rd, that's over 8 million unique combinations of gametes. So note, literally only 1 in 8 million of our gametes are the same as each other. So meiosis actually produces genetic variation because of this independent assortment of chromosomes. All the chromosomes you got from your mom do not pass on in tandem. All the chromosomes from your dad do not pass on in tandem. Instead, you get a random mixture. And so you produce a vast variety of genotypes in your gametes. And that's the result of independent assortment of chromosomes. Then, if we add on top of that, two individuals who've each undergone meiosis, and they made it random, random fertilization really amplifies genetic variability. So here we have mom's egg, okay? So now we're gonna go back a generation, okay? A minute ago, we were thinking about our own gametes. Well, let's think about our parents' gametes, okay? So mom's egg was one of 8 million different combinations it was possible that she could have produced through meiosis. Likewise, dad's sperm, one of 8 million different kinds of sperm that he could have produced because of independent assortment. So just any one of these 8 million then mates with any one of these 8 million of the other parent, of the other mating partner. And you have 8 million combinations from the mom, 8 million combinations from the dad, to produce at random then the zygote, which is now diploid again. And this is now something like 70 trillion possible combinations just within the same family, just with the same woman and the same man. They could have 70 trillion different offspring and they'd never be exactly the same because of independent assortment of the chromosomes that appears in each one of their gametes and then random fertilization of any one egg with any one sperm. So this means within our families, even though these are our closest relatives, we're not genetically identical. So if we have four different couples or two different couples here, and they each had a pair of offspring, then they're not going to be exactly the same. Okay, so this couple has two offspring here. They're quite similar. And these two brothers are quite similar, but they're not genetically identical. Okay, they can't be because of independent assortment, random fertilization of the egg with the sperm. They're going to be somewhat different from each other because of those different combinations of what were then their grandparental genes ending up in their bodies. Now, it does happen that there are in the world out there individuals that are genetically identical to somebody else. And these we see everywhere, and they are identical twins. Now, how is it that identical twins are identical? Okay? Well, it's because they haven't gone through all the steps that I just described for two different offspring from the same set of parents. With monozygotic twins, there will have been independent assortment in the formation of an egg, independent assortment in the formation of a sperm, random fertilization, okay? So this is a truly unique zygote here, okay? But something happens in those first phase of mitosis, and the daughter cells separate. So these are now two separate cells that are genetically identical because they're identical through mitosis. And then those separate cells undergo continued separate mitotic events. They grow up to be identical twins, okay? But originally there was just one zygote, the result of that random fertilization, independent assortment, and it was because these were separated after fertilization by mitosis in that very first step that these are genetically identical to each other and they become identical twins. More common is dizygotic twins, where at ovulation, the mother releases two different ova, so there's two different eggs, and they're fertilized by two different sperm. They then undergo separate development with mitosis, but these are separate zygotes, okay? And so these are fraternal twins with the 1 in 70 trillion chance of being the same. So the actual process of twinning with monozygotic twins is something that happened after fertilization to produce what are essentially clones.